the Peter Chiarelli move. A lot of people saw it coming, expected something to happen. It's happened. Your reaction?
There's a lot of unhappiness in the City of Champion, as they call it in Edmonton, for a long, long time. And you look at the start that they had from the early 2000, you know, with the Stanley Cup run that they had with Chris Pronger. But there hasn't been a whole lot of consistent success in the City of Edmonton. And there's a lot of frustration amongst fans. There's a lot of frustration with the organization, calling it an old boys club, you know, with the Kevin Lowes and Craig McTavish and that organization, that group that was successful in the 80s of winning trophies for this team. But, boy, it's going to get complicated in Edmonton. But because when we look at this lineup is not stacked with talents, not stacked with future. So whoever is going to come in next there is going to have his hands full for sure.
Yeah, I think the biggest problem for Peter Chiarelli was that he tried to make this team into a winner too soon. And maybe they had the success, or they did have the success in his second year. They get in the playoffs, they win a round, they've got Connor McDavid. Wow, everything's going to be great. Everybody thought this was going to be a perennial playoff team. Well, that was maybe a little premature. And what would have been best thing for Peter Chiarelli is if they didn't make the playoffs in his second year, if they actually stayed out of the playoffs a few years and they were able to build through the drafts, then maybe the hastiness of some of the trades that were made that haven't quite worked out in Peter Chiarelli's favor would never have come about. And some of the signings may not come about. So it's very interesting how it all worked out. But either way, the way it's worked out, it is not a good day for Peter Chiarelli or the Edmonton Oilers.
Reader, I'm fascinated by your point. As we look at the timeline of some of the notable transactions for Chiarelli, this one is one that still causes hand-wringing. Tank, you brought it up earlier. If you're going to trade a guy that becomes the league MVP, Adam Larson obviously going through a crisis of confidence. As you see these moves shuffle by, what's your takeaway on what Reader said?
Well, if you're going to trade $100 and somebody's going to give you $50 back, you better make sure that $50 got potential to grow. Meaning, you know, you get a good stock and you can buy, you know, in early on some of those young players. But you look at the Edmonton Oilers and Taylor Hall, you look at the amount of times and the amount of number one picks that they had. Yeah, I'd like to compare it to the Quebec Nordiques in the early 90s, where they had this long stretch of not being successful, and they went to the Matt Sundin, to the Owen Nolan, to the Eric Lindros, and they turned those picks, Joe Sakic, Adam Foote, they turned those picks into a sustainable 10, 12 years, 15 years of franchise success for that organization. Well, what the Edmonton Oilers have done the last, you know, 7 or 8 years, you look at Yakupov, you look at Nugent Hopkins, you look at McDavid, you look at all those guys that were early first-round pick, and now you're stuck in a position where you have to let go of the general manager. Not all is wrongdoing, because Peter Chiarelli wasn't there for the whole time, but they haven't been able to sustain a coach, you know, for any long amount of period of time. They haven't been able to sustain like a general manager that's been able to make decision and for the long-term viability, sustainability of this team. So there's a lot of question mark. And when you have this amount of first-round pick, you think that you would have set your franchise for the next 12, 15, 14 years? Well, now, if you look at the team objectively, Connor McDavid, Leon Draisaitl, Ryan Nugent-Hopkins up front, and the rest of them, I mean, there's a lot of guys that still have a lot of things to prove in order to establish themselves as good full-time NHL players, guys that can play on first two lines, on top three line for that matter. So there's still a lot of question mark with that lineup, and it's gonna be interesting, because the hopes when you go through this misery for this amount of times, and especially from the fans, was that they were going to be able to have the success. And now the success, is it going to come to fruition? Well, I think that there's going to be more time that's going to be needed in order for that to happen.
Here's Peter Chiarelli's statement on being relieved of his duties. I would like to thank the Edmonton Oilers organization, owner Daryl Katz and his family, Bob Nicholson, and the OEG executive group for the opportunity to be GM for the Edmonton Oilers. I wish the Oilers and the players good luck for the remainder of the season and in the future. I'm coming straight to you guys with the way that the statement started. We were all riveted by it. Nicholson said this is a playoff team, and anybody who doesn't believe that is outside the organization. Do you believe this is a playoff team?
No. I'm outside the organization, obviously, but I don't believe they're a playoff team. They've got three players. You mentioned them, and they're top three players, and this is, you know, maybe you could put Darnell Nurse and Oscar Klefbom when he gets back in there. Can't put Adam Larson. He's not playing well enough right now. But they've got the three forwards. They're not a playoff team. Their goaltending has been suspect. The signing of Mikko Koskinen and them has nothing to do with what's going on. It's that he hasn't proven himself to be worthy of saying, yes, you're a good National Hockey League goaltender. You have to be a very good National Hockey League goaltender to get your team into the playoffs. You just can't win with good goaltending. You have to have very good goaltending, because good goaltending means you're in the bottom half of the league, unfortunately. Mm. To me, the Oilers have still got a long ways to go. They've got excellent coaching. They just don't have the horses to get them to the playoffs. Connor McDavid can do all he wants, and he's going to. He's going to do whatever he wants on the ice. He can put up all sorts of points. But the team, to me, just is not strong enough in the conference to be in the top eight in the conference. I'm not sure. Bob Nicholson, I'm not sure if he was – I felt he was talking to the fans at one
sure.
point. You know, trying to say, hey, I really think this is a playoff team. I mean, you've got to – I was a general manager of a team. We weren't a very good team in Peterborough when I was there, but we were rebuilding. We were trying to pick up draft picks. We were trying to start young. He should be looking at his team with open eyes. I knew we didn't have a good team, but that was our game plan. His game plan should be, we need to get better. We're not very good right now. And to me, that's not the message I expected to hear from Bob Nicholson. Mm. If you think you're a playoff team, yeah, I disagree with them. I don't think they're a playoff team.
Sometimes when you're in the confine and the environment of a team, sometimes it's hard to take a look at the big pictures like we're doing right now. You know, we can dissect the lineup. We can look at the defensemen. You know, but where is this team going forward? Do they have enough players to be sustainable over a long period of time? And the question, could they squeeze into the playoff if Koskinen goes on a hot streak, if Klevbom comes back, if Sekera gets back and everybody's healthy and you've got 97 that, you know, can put that Superman cape and do spectacular things, maybe you can get yourself in the playoffs, because you look at the Western Conference
at
right
86
now,
points.
At 86,
at 86 points. 86 points, seriously. 86 points. Minnesota got in how many years ago with 88? Mm-hmm. Like, you need to get 96. So if he thinks they're a playoff team at 86 points, you want to get in the playoffs at 86 points. I'd rather be out of the playoffs. Mm. And you know, be honest with yourself. And normally, and you know, looking at the stat with and without Klefbom, this is a huge difference in the team, is without their stud defenseman with Darnell Nurse and Klefbom are huge in the back end. But when you lose one player, and this goes back to the point of, are they a playoff team, you lose one player and all of a sudden your goals against goes up, your points percentage drops. Well, you're not a playoff team if one guy goes out for a certain amount of time. You know, Minnesota have lost Dumba on the back end. Who would you rather have in your team, Klefbom or Dumba? Well, Minnesota's they're still plugging along. They just didn't, you know, fold the tent. But getting back to the fact that management, when you're in management, you have a public face to show to everybody. But you have that also that face when you close the door and you're sitting in your office and you're shaking your head going, wow, we're not very good. Mm-hmm. We've got to get a lot better. Well, when you fire your coach midseason, then you fire the general manager midseason, you can't come out and tell everybody we're a playoff team. If you're a playoff team, you wouldn't have fired your coach. You wouldn't have fired your general manager. Mm-hmm. I mean, they need to have, you hate to say it, but they need to build from the draft up. And that's where I get back to the point where Peter Chiarelli had success in his second year with the Oilers. He would have been best not to have success. Even though the team had multiple number one picks and the team was the fans were dying for a playoff team, the teams that win are the Nordiques that build through the draft, Pittsburgh Penguins that build through the draft, the Chicago Blackhawks who built through the draft, Los Angeles Kings, Toronto Maple Leafs.
I'm
the most recent
a pattern here.
Yes, you lose. Yeah. You lose consistently. But Edmonton lost consistently, had the number one pick consistently, and continued to lose. So there was all that pressure on Peter Chiarelli, but Peter Chiarelli had to ignore that, but he made the playoffs the second year, and they won a round, and it was like, great, let's add on to this, and let's keep going. Well, that was, you know, that was, in retrospect, that was probably the worst thing that ever happened to Peter Chiarelli in Edmonton.
Wow.
And the problem now is that you've got all those good years. Connor McDavid, you're already on year four of an all-star.
Yeah.
Yes.
Generational players. You're going to waste another 4 years on that?
Yeah.
Time is going to be of the essence in Edmonton.
It's not going to take four. Didn't take the Leafs four.
True.
Didn't take the Leafs four.
Shanahan plan.
You can do it in two. You can do it in two, maybe three, because you've already got Draisaitl, Nugent Hopkins, McDavid. Leafs didn't have that when they started with Matthews. They went Matthews, Marner, Nylander, et cetera, et cetera.